Hello friends, and welcome to another edition of the Hemmings Auctions Week in Review. We're going to take a look at some recent sales from HemmingsAuctions.com. And while you've missed out on these, we have a lot more cars on the site. Please come and take a visit. I know you'll find something that you're tempted to bid on, because I always find something that I'm tempted to bid on, and I'm not even looking to buy something. This week, I'm going to go straight into the auction recaps. And if you want to take a closer look at any of these cars, I've put links to all of the lots in the YouTube description. Also note, all of the prices include a 5% buyer's fee. And just in case you're interested in selling your own car, you can list it with Hemmings Auctions for just $100. First up, a 1971 Ford Pinto drag car sold for $8,100. Now, my first question here is, why would anyone do this? Not that there's anything wrong with it, I'm just curious. And it turns out the Pinto actually was a fairly popular drag car back in the day. It was also popular during SCCA racing. So take note, kids, Pinto history is more than just rear-end explosions and corporate malfeasance. It also has some good parts in it too. I learned so much when I'm making these videos. It really makes me happy. Anyway, this Pinto was and is cheap and light, which means that it's pretty easy to do stuff like make an 11-second drag car with only 300 horsepower. Everything here is based on an original build that took place around when the car was new. They dropped in a 302 V8, installed a 12-point racing harness and underbody bracing, and fully converted it to drag racing spec. It is clearly not street legal, but it looks like it's ready to run. It's still pretty clean. And while 300 horsepower doesn't sound like a lot, a stock 302 in 1971 only made 210 brake horsepower. So that's a pretty impressive build with this engine. Anyway, you know the saying, do one thing, do it well? This Pinto is that in drag racing form. I mean, you can get an 11-second quarter-mile car from the showroom today, but one, it's not going to be as fun, and two, there is no way you will do it for anything close to $8,100. I don't even think you could build this thing for $8,100. So yeah, this Pinto is fun, it's weird, and it is super affordable, and I love it. Next up, a 1957 GMC NAPCO 4x4 conversion panel truck with only 6,900 miles sold for $36,850. You might find this hard to believe, but once upon a time, not all trucks came with four-wheel drive, and yet somehow people still drove in winter. It's kind of crazy. Anyway, in the late 1940s and 50s, you couldn't get factory four-wheel drive on a GM truck. So Northwestern Auto Parts Company, or NAPCO, from Minneapolis, Minnesota, sold kits based on the 4x4 trucks that they made for military trucks during the war to convert stock two-wheel drive into four-wheel drive. In 1956, the NAPCO Power Pack became a factory option on GMCs and then on Chevys in 1957. And then finally, when the CK pickup line came in 1960, GM had its own internal factory four-wheel drive. This truck originally came from the Granby, Colorado Fire Department, which is why the mileage is so low and the condition is so good. They didn't really have a need to drive it that much, and it lived in a really favorable climate. It has new paint, but the engine and most of the rest of it is all original. As a side note, this was a Hemmings find of the day on the website back in 2017, and the auction sale price was just a few hundred dollars less than what that old asking price was, which is a really good reminder that auctions can be a great way to sell a car. You have a ticking clock and you have multiple people competing, and you end up often getting the right price. And on speaking of that price, this one went for more than recent sales of comparable GMC pickups. But again, this was a panel truck, which you rarely see for sale, highly original and low mileage. So good price, cool truck, and I love that paint. This 1994 Chevrolet Impala SS sold for $18,428. The Impala SS was basically a civilian version of the Chevy Caprice cop car. It had rear disc brakes. It had the LT1 V8, like in the Camaro and Corvette, except with iron heads. Here it made 260 horsepower, which was pretty solid back in the day. Overall, the Impala was just a big, badass boat of a car, and I love it. They only made it for 3 years because GM stopped making the large rear-wheel drive B-body in 1996. Those 96s are the most desired versions of the Impala because they had an analog dash and a floor shifter. I like the digital dash. My boss, Terry McGean, has a 96 and he prefers the analog dash. And, you know, I can accept that. They're both great teams. this is a good price, especially given that it's a 94 and not the 96. The average figure for Impalas is a little lower than this, but in general, you're always creeping up around 20 grand if you want a well-preserved example like this one, which has two previous owners and has only seen 1,900 miles since 2015. And, you know, I get with the low miles, you think, you know, this is something that, a car that you want to preserve, but it is really missing out on the experience. I used to have a 94 Buick Roadmaster, which is on the same platform. And I got to tell you, large cars are a way of life. It's just, everything is more relaxing in them. You're just cruising along, you're lounging on the road in the car, and you're looking at everybody else, and they just seem so stressed out. And then someone rolls by and something like a Ford Crown Vic, and you know, you just give them the nod, and you're like, yeah, yeah, I get it. So drive your cars, please. Okay, reasons to buy a Buick Reatta, as exhibited by this 1988 one that sold for $7,000. Handcrafted in Lansing, Michigan, which is where I'm from, which is pretty cool. But also, that's the same building where they made the EV1 electric car and the Chevrolet SSR convertible truck. Pretty neat. Digital touchscreen. I cannot stress enough how cool this is. Buick put these things in the Riviera as well, but the Reatta made it famous. Not always for good reasons. A lot of them failed. It was a long time before anyone else tried a touchscreen again. But now everything has a touchscreen, so this is cool in an almost steampunk way. Think about it that way. You also get to join a community of like-minded enthusiasts dedicated to keeping the Reatta alive, including the Reatta Owners Club website, which is a really good resource, the Reatta Division of the Buick Club of America, and this Twitter account with 61 followers. It also has the 3800 V6. These engines will run forever. They're bulletproof, and if anything goes wrong with them, there are probably a million of them in the salvage parts supply line, and you can always be tempted to upgrade to a supercharged 3800. And lastly, affordability. Riatas, they haven't taken off in the collector market at all, like not even Cadillac Elante levels, which means good examples like this don't cost that much. And they're just really great time capsules of 80s American car luxury. I love them. I love all the cars, but I like the Reatta a little more than other ones. Last up, a 1985 BMW M6 sold for $42,536. And this one's pretty too. I just really like it. Look closer though, not just at those cool Alpina wheels, but at the bumper and the cool yellow Euro headlights. This is the Euro-spec version, which means the Euro-spec engine, which means 282 horsepower. And mind you, this is from an inline six that out of 3 liters in an inline six in 1985. That is a lot of specific output. But more importantly, it's about 30 horsepower more than the lower compression engine that came in the US spec M6 starting in 1986. This is one of those cars that made you want a BMW, like any BMW, just to get a taste of the magic. And the M6 specifically, it just did everything well. You know, it was like fast, comfortable, beautiful. It's like the Franz Beckenbauer of German sports cars. It's just almost annoying at how good it is. And speaking of annoying, this price is that, mostly because I can't afford it. But seriously, in terms of other recent M6 sales, it's a little bit above average. I would say the price is probably pretty good given the high mileage, but it's still a lot cheaper than some of the really crazy prices you've seen for low mileage examples, which bumps up into 60 and 80,000 and above. And the other good thing about a high mileage car is you can drive it and you're not going to hurt the value. That's the theme this week, drive the cars. And speaking of driving, that's what our comment of the week is about. This one is pertaining to a 1963 Ford Falcon Futura convertible on the auctions. And quote, "In 1965, my new bride and I drove one of these from the Panama Canal Zone to Fort Ord, California. 11 days on the unfinished Pan Am Highway, with all our worldly goods strapped to the rear deck and two jerry cans bolted to the trunk." And how cool is that story? It's amazing. I'm going to have to follow up and get some photos. But if you have a good story related to an auction car, or if you have anything else to say, head to HemmingsAuctions.com and please add your own comments. And where should you put those comments? Glad you asked. How about one of the new cars we have going up every single day? Here are some examples of auctions that are live right now as of this taping. We have a 1977 Chevrolet Monte Carlo Landau with a beautiful two-tone paint job, a 1950 Ford F1 with flathead V8 power, this 1985 Mercury Capri RS with a high output 5.0 and a 5-speed manual. And yes, I know the 5.0 is really a 4.9. We're just going to stick with the official name. This 1954 Ford Crestline Skyliner with a see-through glass roof and an all-original 1962 Corvette with less than 43,000 miles on it. As I keep saying, we have many more cars and trucks on the website, so please come visit. And while you're there, be sure to sign up for the newsletter to get that Hemmings Auctions in your email inbox every single morning. That's all for this week. See you next time.